Hello and welcome to The World in 8 Minutes, a new show by People's Dispatch where we bring to you stories of resistance from people's movements across the world. Today, we report from one of the hundreds of sites of what is perhaps the largest worker strike in the history of humankind. Nearly 200 million Indian workers are on strike over a series of 12 major demands. The strike is led by 10 central trade unions. This strike comes at a very key point in India's history. The far-right Narendra Modi government has brutally failed in its promises of delivering jobs for youth. Unemployment is soaring. But the government, instead of providing jobs, has actually introduced legislation which makes it more difficult for workers to organize. It is in this context that the workers who are striking today have put forward 12 demands. Some of them include concrete measures to ensure that employment is generated for everybody. The workers are also demanding that all labour laws be implemented properly. They have also asked for a minimum wage of ₹18,000 for a month, which comes to close to around $265. They are asking for pensions for everybody as well as social security.
The Modi government has been continuously pursuing the pro-corporate policies, and one thing is that they are not at all implementing the labour legislation which is earned through the years of struggles, but in spite they were amending the existing labor laws for having a free hire and fire system for the corporates. And here to the latest, even after, means just 1 week before this strike is announced, means strike is to take place, they have brought the trade union amendment bill, which is to even curtail the trade union rights and the recognition of the trade unions. So this, and then the bills of various kinds, the 44 labor laws have been changed into four labor codes, which is to curtail all the, even the social security benefits and the right to freedom of association also. And also the latest to that is to for the promotion of the contractorization, the fixed term employment ordinance also this government has brought in.
Considering the amount of disinvestment that is taking place, the unions are demanding that there be no foreign direct investment in key sectors such as defense and railways. They are also demanding an end to all sorts of contractualization and formalization of jobs of workers. This strike is a key moment in India's history. The workers across the country in hundreds of locations are carrying out similar rallies such as this, united in their demand that they need more jobs and that enough is enough, and they will not take the anti-worker policies of the Modi government anymore.
The two-day strike called by Central Trade Unions, rather than BMS, has seen unprecedented success in the entire country, including Delhi. There have been industrial areas which have been completely shut down, and government establishment which have been partially affected. We can see bank employees who have participated in it. We have seen big industrial areas like Bhavana or Narela, which have seen working class action on an unprecedented scale. And in Delhi particularly, this kind of strike, we had been trying for a long time. In 2015, we saw a good response. 2nd September, 2016, again we saw a good response. But this time, the workers are really fed up. They are saying that the kind of inflation that has set up, that has set in the country, and the unemployment rate because of GST and Notbandi, a large number of small-scale industries have closed down, causing a lot of workers to lose their job. That has caused a lot of anger among the workers. And they are out on the street expressing it. They are with the strike and they have successfully implemented it on the second day as well.
The call for this historic strike was given in September, where on this very Parliament Street, workers, farmers and agricultural workers staged a massive rally in which they condemned the anti-worker, anti-poor policies of the Modi government. In November, hundreds and thousands of farmers marched from across the country to Parliament once again, demanding farm loan waivers, as well as a variety of reforms to ensure that farmers could lead a stable life. Even this strike today is supported by farmers, agricultural workers, students' organizations, and a variety of organizations across the country. For more stories of struggle, on this week's episode of The World in 8 Minutes, we head back to the studio.
Following the unrelenting strike by doctors, teachers in Zimbabwe have also announced a nationwide strike. Teachers and doctors in Zimbabwe receive among the lowest pay in the world for their professions. The teachers are demanding a pay rise from their current salaries of $500 to $3,000. Unions claim $500 are not sufficient for teachers to even afford enough food for their families. They are also demanding that they be paid in US dollars rather than bond notes pegged to the US dollar, which is the current system of payment. The Progressive Teachers Union of Zimbabwe stated in its petition to the government last month that teachers don't have enough money to even report to duty. Apart from the erosion of real incomes of teachers, the country is also suffering from an acute shortage of teachers. According to the chief executive of the Zimbabwe Teachers Association, the pupil-to-teacher ratio in the country is at 1:70, and sometimes it even goes up to 1:101 in the worst-case scenario. But there have been no increases in the education budget to address this crisis. The long queues at fuel stations, empty supermarket shelves, shortage of medicines, doctors and teachers not having enough money to report to duty all suggest that these reforms, sold by neoliberal pundits as a prescription for fixing the economy, are not proving to be a solution in Zimbabwe, just as they didn't anywhere else in the world. Only 9 days have passed since 2019 began, and almost 10 social leaders and human rights defenders in Colombia have been killed. The phenomenon of right-wing paramilitary violence and state violence against Colombian leaders surged in 2018. Human rights organizations estimate that more than 200 social leaders were assassinated last year, and since the Havana peace agreements were signed in September 2016, more than 400 leaders have been assassinated. With these alarming numbers that continue to climb, social movements and organizations have questioned the political will of the Colombian government to protect the lives of Colombia's leaders. On January 6, peasant leader Maritza Isabel Lieva was shot dead on a small farm near the Caribbean city of Santa Marta. Lieva was part of the district roundtable of victims and was also a land claimant. She was actively fighting for the rights of peasants in her region. Maritza was a mother to 4 children and is the 6th social leader to be assassinated in 2019. The National Agrarian Coordinator, a platform of peasant organizations in Colombia, released a statement on January 5 condemning the wave of assassinations and persecution. They said that contrary to what the government is claiming, it is not guaranteeing the full rights of citizens. Instead, the government is infringing on all rights, like the right to life, mobilization, organization, among others. That's all for this episode of Around the World in 8 Minutes. For more stories and videos about people's movements, please check out our website, peoplesdispatch.org, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube.
Tú vendrás marchando junto a mí.